I used to think that people are going to do what they're going to do, and there's nothing I can do about it, so why dwell on it? You know, and the future has to go on, you know, and we can't continue to do what we're doing. Because my grandkids, my great-grandkids, long after I'm dead and gone, they're going to be paying for it, you know. And for what, money?
The human race depends on pollination. I mean, you lose pollinators, you lose plants, you lose people. It's just that simple.
For the past decade, scientists have been trying to figure out why so many of the country's honeybees have been dying. Honeybees are a crucial part of our food chain, but the population in the U.S. has been declining at an alarming rate. Some believe climate change partly to blame, but scientists and bee farmers are now pointing their finger at a different culprit, pesticides. And earlier this week, I spoke with Minnesota-based commercial beekeeper James Cook. Cook just completed a cross-country tour to bring attention to the issue. He drove a truck with a display of 2.5 million dead bees to help demonstrate the scale of the problem.
My name is James Cook. Along with my wife Sam, we help manage around 2,300 beehives. During our first spring, we were standing in a holding yard with most of our operations hives. As a farmer started to plant corn seed treated with pesticides, a light wind carried dust across the bee yard. It only took a few minutes for the bees to start exhibiting the deadly effects of a pesticide poisoning. We witnessed bees lying on their backs, twitching as though they were having seizures. By the week's end, well over half the adult bees were dead. We reported this incident to the Minnesota Department of Agriculture. The state inspector came out and brought along some pesticide industry scientists to investigate the death of our bees. They came to the conclusion that a systemic pesticide had played a role in poisoning the bees, but for this time of year it was considered an acceptable loss as the hives should rebound over summer. But they didn't. By that summer's end, we had lost over 70% of the hives in our operation. Since that event, I could tell story after story of how the toxic environment we keep bees in has become more alarming. Our hives only represent a tiny portion of the pollinators that exist in America's landscape, and very little of that story is being told. So along with a few million dead bees to help illustrate the problem, I'm heading out across the country in search of farmers, scientists, beekeepers, and communities working towards solutions to bring their stories to the policymakers in Washington, D.C., and demand that they protect pollinators.
I believe in the good things coming, 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 coming. I believe in the good things coming, 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 coming. Out of darkness, line are pumping, pumping, pumping.
My life would have been so much easier if I had just decided to ask different research questions. But that wasn't going to solve, I mean, this planet is facing some serious threats right now. As far as, you know, the effects of pesticides on bees, like neonicotinoids, which are a seed treatment that's systemic within the plant, very toxic to bees. The problem with these chemistries is that right now they are truly being used on, I estimate, approximately 13% of the terrestrial land surface of North America. 13% of the land surface. Under that exposure scenario, you've got a situation where it's tough to avoid being contaminated with these chemistries. We can associate pesticide use with declines in the bees, but the pesticide is a symptom. The problem is not enough diversity in the landscape and too much disturbance in the landscape. We went down a road with agriculture decades ago that said that the way to harness the land is by tilling it and by disturbing that soil. And the only way you can maintain control is by tilling it more every year, multiple times a year. And what ended up happening is, as a consequence of that, we lost most of the biology in our soil, or we changed those biological communities. We need as much of that biology in the soil because that's how the fertilizer gets into the plants. That's how That's how weeds become suppressed, is by competition from all of these other biological agents. That's how pests in the soil are overcome. You reestablish those biological balances. And the first step in that process, we call it sort of regenerative agriculture, because we're rebuilding those communities, we're regenerating soil health and biodiversity in our farms. The first step is stop tilling. The reality is that if we don't reform our food production systems, our bees are gonna continue to suffer. If we only solve the pesticide problem, or if we just provide habitat without solving some of these other issues, then we're not gonna move that ball down the field. What does the future of agriculture look like if we don't change our current direction? The first thing that's going to happen is our soils are going to be dead. They're not going to produce crops anymore. And that is the downfall of civilization. The fact that we have to continually add additional inputs into our soil to make our crops productive is a key example of the fact that our soils are no longer share that fertility that once there was. But what's so exciting and what is so inspirational is that the solution is there. And we know what to do as far as stopping tillage, increasing vegetative cover and diversity of plants within our farmscapes, integrating animals back into those systems. Those are key elements. We know it. I mean, scientifically, it's there and it's proven, right? Now we need to start getting that into, you know, systems where farmers are adopting that.
After talking with Jonathan, I wanted to find some local farmers who are already putting these practices to work.
I started farming here, I suppose I was about 16 years old, probably 1994. My grandpa immigrated over here from Sweden and the other one from Denmark, and they both come over and they were farmers. I used to be a big skeptic of all this. I was just as big a skeptic as anybody else. This is about 5 years ago, and I thought cover crops were, I ain't gonna mess with that. You can't raise small grain around here, that doesn't work, you know. And you gotta approach it from a perspective where you can't be biased. I mean, you've gotta be open to accept that maybe you could be wrong, you know. And that's kind of hard to do. When you plant the same crop too many years in a row, that leaves pathogens and insects in the soil, and when you spread out the food source, then all those pathogens, they just can't overwinter, they can't survive if you wait long enough between cycles. And so that's something we're trying to do on the farm, where we're raising probably about 8 different crops, not every year, but you know, we're raising, you know, buckwheat and Japanese millet, corn, soybeans, oats, winter wheat, spring wheat, peas. You know, we're trying a lot of different things, and then we're cover cropping after our small grain. I would say this is probably pretty fair right here. You know, look at that, see that? I should get a screwdriver for you guys too. That's just the chocolate cake. So once you, if you go and you flake it up, and you won't believe the worms that are in here too.
Wow.
Now you go over there, we should go over there.
Go.
See how hard that is? What I'd eventually like to do long term is that make this corridor the organic corridor. You know, part of the problem is that chemicals and all this, all these other things made farming really easy. Mm-hmm. And with easy, you can farm a lot of land and hopefully make a lot of money. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's why people, I think, fight it so much, because they don't want to go back to all that extra management, because then you can't farm half the countryside. I just had a friend of mine I was talking to the other day. We clicked on an article that this guy had written about soil health. You know what he talked about in this article from 1901?
I can only imagine.
You need to reduce your tillage, you need to cover crop, you need to bring animals back on and use manure. You know, it's, you know, gotta, you know, you want higher, you know, better microbial communities in the soil. I mean, the guy, everything he wrote on there was right there. And we seem to think we reinvented the wheel. This is all an art that was lost, you know, when our great-grandparents started spraying, you know, MCPA, you know. So we're just kind of relearning it.
Yeah. moth. Kind of during the middle of the day, they're not as hungry, so they don't come running, but if you get them in the morning, they'll just come stampeding across the pasture. Come on. I'm Jessica Cruzy. Grew up on a family farm my whole life, and within the last few years of transition to raising, you know, more organic, grass-fed, intensive grazing, short duration, and trying to implement more than just one species. So cattle, sheep, got chickens, got llamas, looking to add more poultry and stuff like that into the mix as well. So this land here, most of it was cropland when my dad got a hold of it, and we've transitioned it into pasture. Anywhere, any given time on this place is going to be flowers for the pollinators, and you can see the grass when you're looking out in there, but there's so many legumes and so many flowers out there. When we're walking through there on a calm day, you can just hear the buzzing of all the bees, and it's like the coolest thing in the world. I just love it, knowing that like we can create that habitat and we can have that diversity. We don't need to bring all of our own stuff on to have diversity. Nature can do that with us, and we can work together instead of constantly doing this tug of war and trying to fight Mother Nature. My dad and my grandpa, they've always taught us, you know, you want to leave the land better than when you got it. You know, you want to keep improving. So we've always kind of had this open mind of, we're going to listen to what people are saying, and we're going to take that information and we're going to do something with it. We're not going to be defensive and prideful about, you know, this is what we're doing it, so it must be right. When you feed corn to cattle, you mess up their hormones. You know, they'll get corn and soy, silage, you know, distiller's grain. And from that point on, end up in a feedlot where they're actually getting fed things like Doritos and waffle cones. And I mean, just like these horrible supplements that cattle are not supposed to be eating. If you're feeding your kid a diet that looks like that, something that they're not designed to eat, they're gonna, you know, they're gonna get big, they're gonna end up having health issues. So why would we expect that to happen any different with the animals that we're feeding? Just because they're alive doesn't mean they're healthy. And just because, you know, you're trying to raise beef to feed the world, you know, I want to nourish the world. I don't want to just feed the world. I want to bring health to people through the food that I'm creating. And so to keep them eating the diet that they're supposed to, it makes all the difference in the world. Most farmers really want to do the best job that they can. They take pride in their work. They want, you know, they want to be on the land. This isn't something that's going to take 30 years to reverse. Like, if we can just get holistic management back on the land, we can reverse this a lot faster than the damage has been done. You know, sure. Mother Nature is resilient, and the fact that we haven't killed her yet, it shows us that she can heal, yeah. and we can bring it back to the way it was.
Deep breath for a young man, learning. Now I know most stories start with the main character heading west, but I need to head in the opposite direction. Next stop, Montevideo, Minnesota. Every fire kindle burning. I
believe in the good things coming. We read about the neonicotinoids, the systemic insecticides, and said, this has got to stop. So what can we do? We tried to find a group that we could join and be part of, and it didn't exist in our area. So we really want somebody else to do it, but we said, well, we have to do something. So we decided to start a Be Safe City campaign and a Be Safe Yard campaign. And then we wanted to pass a resolution in one small city so that it could be used as a prototype for other cities. They could figure out that if these people can do it, so can we. After 6 months, they passed the resolution and have continued to order, make sure that the plants they get on city property, that they're free of neonicotinoids and other systemics, and they agreed not to use systemics on the property, and people are coming around and learning themselves.
These little guys, as they sprouted out up all over the community, and I started seeing this, what that told me is the people who vote me in to do this, they support this. It didn't dawn on me that we as a city could be a part of that solution until Patricia and all of the others came to us. And really what they did were two things. Sounds simple, but it wasn't, but educate us and then offer a solution. And it was a really easy solution. It wasn't tough. It didn't cost a lot of money. You start right from the grassroots. When they know that you have a serious interest about this, they're going to start thinking twice, because they're there to get elected. If they don't get your vote, they aren't in.
Woo!
people in this neighborhood, there's a lot of gardeners, plus the river is right down there, so the honey ends up just tasting very different.
I'm owner of the Bee's Knees here in Minneapolis. We're a pedal-powered beekeeping business. We teach classes, we deliver honey by bicycle, and we keep about 150 hives in and around the Twin Cities. In 2013, we had an acute pesticide poisoning on one of our hives alongside two other beekeepers, and we ended up going through an investigation with the Minnesota Department of Agriculture and the University of Minnesota Bee Lab. And we discovered what killed our bees, but we could not figure out who did it. So we started a campaign called Healthy Bees, Healthy Lives. In 2014, we went to the Capitol and we testified 5 times. And we're instrumental in 2 Minnesota pollinator laws passing. One of them is a beekeeper compensation bill that would compensate us for our hives if we were to ever experience that again, which we did. And the other one was for just a truth in advertising bill that would make nurseries not label things as bee-friendly if they'd been pre-treated with systemic insecticides. When I went out to look at those hives with someone who works with a lot of beekeepers, I asked her how many beekeepers she knows that have had pesticide kills, and she said everybody has a story. And that's frightening, that we as beekeepers are, we can see this visibly in our bees, and there's a lot of ego in beekeeping, taking care of animals, farming. There's pride in what you produce, which is part of the reason you do it. And so I think that people don't want to admit that something's wrong because then it reflects poorly upon them. But, you know, it's not about your ego. It's about all of us. I think there's a big shift. A lot of people are really starting to get it. It's just now about taking action, and it has to happen. I mean, we don't really have a choice. If there are enough people that go to the legislature and push hard enough, it's amazing what can happen.
Yeah, so right now I'm going up a hill, slowing down to 65, and the boost is only showing 5. Is it something detrimental, or should I keep driving?
Oh, it's gonna suck. It's gonna be hot, but I think I can fix it.
It's been frustrating as hell, and now we have the answer. It's right there. Super simple. Hose clamp. See that? I just took it off. It's off.
As I was working on the truck engine, it dawned on me that it was the perfect metaphor for our broken food system. When one part fails, the whole system breaks down.
We're back.
It's working. The code's gone, and we have power back. It's right here we come.
Deep breaths for a young man, learning, 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 learning. Take a walk with the cedars, I'm in. Cityscape, pink sunset, stunning. Every empty space is filling. Every fire kindle burning. I believe in the good things coming, 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 coming.
Come this way, come, come, come. We're inside Rouge Park, which is the largest park in the city of Detroit. And the section of the park that our farm was located in is called the Myers Tree Nursery. And so we have 7 acres inside of this 200-acre section. It's not just production, but it's people's perception of what a farm is in Detroit. Getting this land was quite an ordeal. We've been here since 2008. And initially we asked the city just to give us 2 acres of city-owned land to do an organic farm. And they really didn't know how to process that request. And so we kind of got bounced from department to department. But in May of 2008, they asked us to come out here and look around. We liked this section in particular because it was a wide open space. We didn't have to bring chainsaws out and cut trees down. And the second reason we liked it is because if you go to the back of the farm and go about 100 yards to the right, there's a fire hydrant. And so we figured if there was a fire hydrant, that means we have water access, right? That was our logic. But for the first year, nobody from the city could figure out how to turn that hydrant on. If you notice, there's this tall plant that's growing in the walking paths. We cover cropped all of this with rye and hairy vetch during the winter, and some of it in the walking paths is coming back up. But we do cover cropping so we don't just leave the growing areas bare. So we have to put a lot more time and energy into animal management than most people in Detroit do. The major animal problem we have is what? What do you think? Groundhogs. Groundhogs don't drink water. They get all of their water from plants. And so nice succulent things like collard greens and kale, they love. And what we didn't realize is that by putting the fence up, we also fenced out coyotes. And frankly, I didn't know until I came out here to this farm there were coyotes in Detroit, but there are. And the coyote are the major predator of the groundhogs out here. So when we fenced out the deer, we also fenced out the coyote. And so the natural predator of the groundhog was gone, and they had all this organic produce, so the groundhogs were proliferating. So the lesson for us is that you can't think about anything in isolation. Everything happens in relationship. And so, you know, that's a lesson for just how we move through life in general, I think.
At D-Town Farm, I met a man named Paul who invited me to come stay with his community in East Detroit.
Andy's gonna be down in half an hour. Okay. Yeah, there's some in there. Get you some. All right, here we go. It's kind of like a magical place back here.
Yeah.
For the kids love to come back here, and we just kind of cut a path.
Bees kind of teach you about communities and how they have their different jobs and, you know, the undertakers and nursery bees and all that stuff. It's just an amazing thing in this little box that you can analyze a whole, how it reflects on us and our culture. Well, I'm a worker bee, I'm the queen or whatever.
This is a building and my son's got a bike shop, the guy you met this morning there, and we're kind of getting it off the ground.
But we got some work to do.
Yeah.
Got just a little work, you know.
We all have agriculture in our backgrounds. Somebody's planting carrots, a big deal. You know, when you think of all the stuff to do for that carrot, it's cheaper to buy it from the farmer, right? But there's something intrinsic about doing it yourself or being in touch or appreciating the farm. When you grow a carrot and it's all squiggly and not growing right, and you see the perfect carrot, you go, you appreciate the carrots. Most of the kids in rural areas have agri-science programs. There's no agri-science programs in urban areas. Don't those kids have the right to be involved in agriculture and seek a job? So this little kid in the city says, I want to be a farmer. How can they do that? They don't have that. So I think you wouldn't, if you said to the farmers, oh, you don't need computers, you're just going to be on a tractor, you don't need to study that, they'd say, no, my kid could be whatever they want to be. And you probably aren't going to see kids at a rally say, it's unfair, we don't have agriculture. You know, they're not going to protest, they don't even know it. They don't even know what they're missing, you know. So, like, the bee issue, you know. Hey, they don't know it. If they knew it, they'd be lobbying with us and saying, hey, they'd be calling the senators, but how do we educate people to tell them about the issues and then get them to help out solve them, you know.
Some years, honey producer, migratory beekeeper, pollinating a lot of crops. I guess we run bees in six states right now. In September of 2006, in early October, I shipped six semi-loads of bees out of here back to Florida to go to Brazilian pepper, which is a plant that blooms in the fall of the year. So went by there late in the afternoon on the 12th of November, went out in the field where they sat. And after I smoked four or five pallets, just something told me there's something wrong here, and I started opening lids, and there's nobody home. And I mean, open up, here's a handful of bees. Next one has pretty good looking beehive. The next one's completely empty. They're sitting on a gravel lot, and I'm looking on the ground, there's no dead bees. I mean, there's no dead bees. I mean, that whole 400 hives of bees, you couldn't have found enough bees to fill a 5-gallon bucket. I literally got down on my hands and knees and crawled around and looked under the pallets for dead bees. I mean, that's how frustrated I was. My son's sitting on the forklift, and I've never been short on words. And he's, what's wrong? And I, you know, I can't even talk to him. I mean, seriously, I was just, you know, dumbfounded. First of February, early February, my son, who's a movie maker in Philadelphia, called me one morning and he says, Dad, you're on the front page of the Philadelphia Inquirer this morning that you have discovered colony collapse disorder. Well, I didn't even know what colony collapse disorder was. And within 2 days, I was on four, I was in 400 newspapers around the world, must have talked to 500 reporters, and I couldn't get away from a telephone that rang constantly. Something had changed in these bees' environment. I go back to 2003 and 4, and I look around and where I keep bees, and so what changed in that time period? And interesting enough, the only thing that changed was pesticide usage, or what we were using for pesticides. This is when, you know, systemic pesticides basically made their big launch to make their big appearance in the ag and, you know, residential, so on and so forth. And it was sure a great sales pitch. We've spent a lot of time, you know, writing comments on different things to EPA and visiting EPA and the USDA and, you know, all the governmental agencies. And one of the things early on that EPA told us, if you don't like the way we're doing things, the only answer you got is to sue us. And so there's been several lawsuits filed, you know, over the years, and we haven't lost any cases, but unfortunate problem is that even though the judges have told EPA to do this and that and the other thing, they're slow to do it. And what that tells me is that they're still getting a lot of pressure from industry, from the chemical industry, to not do it. You know, how long will it take for, you know, change? We're all seem to be trying to work for the same change here. And I went to a farmer meeting the other night and was just overwhelmed to hear that these guys, three different gentlemen sitting across the table from me at the picnic table, talking about what they're doing and talking enthusiastic about how they're changing their farming practices. And I look up and down this valley and fellows my age that are hardened in the fact that they're chemical farmers, yet when I hear what their sons are up to and where their sons want to go, we're going to do a lot more cover cropping and we're going to do a lot of this stuff that, you know, we're going to make some changes.
Hartmut Döbel. I'm a professor of biology at George Washington University. We are looking at whether those low sublethal dosages of pesticides that are kind of harmless to bees, in quotation marks, by the lawmaker, you know, they're not killing the bees. And then we're looking at those effects on their behavior, and we find effects there. Bees forget stuff we have trained them, and these are sublethal dosages that are not even considered in the application process. If one bee exposed to these sublethal dosages has the effect, then bees that have been exposed on their foraging trip to these sublethal dosages and bring that to the hive and then they feed their larvae with that, it has to have an effect. So we are now looking also at the immune system of larvae and how that affects the, is affected by these low level of pesticides. Initially, when I started off, I think one of the pesticide companies tried to win me over, and you know, I don't want to go into too many details there, but it was just something I found a little bit odd to getting some money from them for something, so I refused to accept that. You know, that should not happen.
The system has to be ratcheted back to work better for protecting pollinators, protecting the American public, protecting our food supply. And frankly, EPA, which regulates the pesticides over the last 40 years under a really bad law, one of the major things that they did 20 years ago or so was they allowed seeds coated with neonics and other similar pesticides to be exempt from having to be registered as pesticides. USDA has a huge research arm. You probably know about Jonathan Lundgren and his work there. Jonathan was an example of a progressive scientist who really wanted to answer some of these questions about what's the effect of coated seeds, neonics, and the whole field. And Jonathan eventually ran into a bureaucracy that didn't want him to be asking those questions. What do the studies show about what farmers are really gaining from using seeds coated with neonic insecticides? It's very clear that for soybeans, there's no benefit whatsoever. It's probably the case for corn as well, but EPA has stifled the study that they were doing on it. If there's no benefit to the farmers, really, in the long run, when you add up what they have to pay for the coatings and what the benefit is nationally from production, then why do we have these products on the market? It would seem the only reason they're on the market is to line the pockets of the chemical industry. So that doesn't make any sense, does it? They have good advertising budgets, they're making, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars in profit, but for what? Who's benefiting? If the public cares enough about this and makes enough noise, then eventually they're gonna hear the message, but it's gotta be said loud and clear.
We started in Brookings, South Dakota. We made it here to Washington, D.C. to give a congressional brief this morning. The voices along the way have given me some amazing inspiration and some really great hope that there are some changes on the horizon. All of their hope and energy, I've been taking it along with me, and I couldn't be prouder to be in front of everybody today.
We need to save the pollinators, but we need to change the system, because farming is a system. Everything is interdependent. That's why, as an organic farmer, we tend to rely on biodiversity and crop rotation, and animals as part of that rotation. We need the government to stop supporting this monocrop agriculture that is killing not only our planet, the soils, the pollinators, but the people.
Keep the hives alive! Keep the hives alive!
Americans care deeply about this problem. In fact, these boxes represent Americans submitting nearly 5 million comments telling EPA to keep the hives alive by banning bee-killing pesticides.
We will succeed in this in the long run. And the people you're really defending on in the long run are right back there. The young people, you have to remember, a statesman is a politician who stands up straight because they're under equal pressure from all sides. Industry will apply their pressure. You've got to be pushing back.
Keep the hives alive! Keep the hives alive! Keep the hives alive!
I believe in the good things. The incredible people I've met along the way are living proof that this movement is growing and that a paradigm shift has begun. We can solve planetary scale problems using our food production system. Everyone can take action. You hold the keys to changing the toxic environment our food is grown in. Help us engage with local, state, and federal governments to protect pollinators from pesticides and to support a future full of sustainable agriculture.
Good things coming, 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 coming. Out of darkness, line are pumping, 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 pumping. into white light, all things running, 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 running. Who have I been? Who am I becoming? Coming, 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 coming. Deep breaths for a young man, learning, 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 learning. Take a walk with the cedars, I'm in. Cityscape, pink sunset, stunning. Every empty space is filling. Every fire kindle burning. I believe in the good things coming, 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 coming. I believe in the good things coming.